Got it.
Hey, I'm so excited today. I've got one of my favorite guests, Camila Budova. Camila is a slow fashion coach. She's also author. She published two books.
Wait.
She's three books. I'm sorry, Camila. You have to name them all later on for us all, where we can find them. She's mom. She is fashion visionary. She's amazing, inspirational woman. And I thought, you know what? I have to bring Camila to you. You have to listen to what she say. Her amazing ideas. Without further ado, Camila, I'm gonna pass on to you to introduce yourself and give us a bit of background. What does slow fashion coach means? And how your story began.
Wow, it's a lot. You will maybe have to guide me through, Julia. I was like, stop me if I speak too much. Yeah, so hello, everybody. It's my great pleasure to be invited to Julia's show. I am Czech of origin, based in Paris, where I'm teaching sustainable fashion and circular economy for fashion industry since many years. And it all started with my corporate career. So I lived in London and I worked in London and in Paris. And I was so passionate about fashion and I wanted to make it in fashion until the moment when I first realized like, being a designer in fashion, it's not really creative work today because everything is just a copy and paste of the trends, like literally. Copy and paste of what the competition has. And then if you are in a management, basically it's a corporation. So it is all about making profits. And really people and planet don't count in this process. And I saw it in the backstage. I saw really the ugly side of the fashion industry. And I was so touched personally in my work by the Far East Asian countries where we were doing business, and I was placing the orders and pushing on the deadlines, and there was still like the pressure there on the prices and on the time is so big that nothing else counts. We are losing people, we are losing environment. And I was like, okay, it's too dirty. I can't work in it anymore. So this was pretty early in my career. Like I did 2 years in my career in a fashion. And after 2 years, I was like, okay, I got enough. I've seen enough. And since then on, I then did my MBA in fashion business, all dedicated to sustainability. And
Wow.
this is like, it was my really personal input, you know? The program was just business. And anything they asked me, I was like, okay, I'll do it sustainable. Okay, I'll do it sustainable. On my capstone, which is like the thesis at your MBA, right? I was coming with like NGOs ideas on how to introduce sustainable fashion faster. But today, the mission really, you know, I'm going deeper and deeper in this question of how can we bring more meaning to fashion. I don't even want to call it sustainable fashion, but really meaningful fashion, like to
Before
create a
you're gonna
sustainable.
reveal all that to us, let me just summarize. So you wanted to be in fashion, since like young age, and you had this big dream to be in fashion. You wanted to be like you started in London, then you went to Paris, right? Paris obviously is the center of fashion, all the glamour, all the glossiness and attraction. But when you actually went to work in an industry and seen behind the scenes, it was completely different story, right? It was all about profits. It was putting pressure and targets on those factories in East Asia to deliver the results at cost of our planet and at cost of people.
Yeah, and you know, Julia, it's not only that it's all about profits. This is like making money is normal. Businesses have to. It's really like the way we do it because there's so much pressure and this industry is so fast. You know, like you see that there are like systems that are put in place to make sure that the workers are safe and that the environment is respected and all this. But if you really work down in the supply chain, which I did, I worked in Germany before as well. And when you work down the supply chain in the manufacturing, the production, the textiles, you see it's lies. Like the people are just able to sign a paper to get the business. Like code of conduct, we apply all this code of conduct, they sign it. And then I know it's not true. Like I've seen it. I was so close to it before that when you say like, yeah, but they signed it. I'm like, yeah, they signed it. but the conditions you are giving to these suppliers are not healthy enough for them to pay their workers correctly. Like, it's too, like, you know. So when I saw this, yeah, like, and I, you know, like, I also know this feeling that you are working in the company and you feel like, but I'm sure that our company does this well. You know, I so want to believe it. It's a huge structure, and we have all these like capsule collections with organic cotton, and you know, there's like, it's a big company, and we tend to trust them, and even more we tend to trust luxury, for example. They have such a huge like income, they have such a huge budget to create a product. Why would they do it wrong? But they still do, you know. It's incredible, like, you can find toxic chemicals in luxury clothes, and if you go down the supply chain, you will find things that, you know, it, for me, it was really like, it's moving around the planet as well, you know. This, like, originally all these sweatshops were in Liverpool, New York. It was like really in our own geographic part, right? So there would be like people who are rich and people who are in such a bad situation, existential situation, that they would take any job, even if they are really not paid fair money for it, and they would be really living in the poverty through all their life, not sending the kids to school, name it, they would still go and do this work because they are in such a position that they have no choice. So it was originally, it was here, and now the scandals are even coming back to Europe, by the way. But, and then it moved like to China. Now from China, it moved to India, Bangladesh, like China and India, then Bangladesh, and now it's Ethiopia. It's moving around the planet, you know. And today what we see in the economic situation, it's almost a question, it might come back on us. What if our children are going to be in the situation that the people on the other side of the world are going to decide, like, they will impose and they will put rules and they will push on prices, and our kids are going to work overtimes and literally die because of the exhaustion, malnourishment, all that crap that's going on. You cannot go to the doctor if you are working in an apparel factory, you know, like, they are hiding that they are pregnant until the last minute because they would lose a job the moment they would show that they are pregnant. It's like, I would cry anytime I speak about it. It's harsh. And I saw really in the backstage how it, and I wanted to believe it also for a long time. I was like, but you know, this company that I was working for was producing in Romania, and it's European Union, and the textile is from Turkey, and I've been to Istanbul, it's an okay country. You want to always like in your head, and I think if you are a consumer, you do it when you're shopping. You want to believe that the piece of clothing you're buying is the one that was made in good conditions. You will accept this. You will never think like, this was made in conditions of modern slavery. Of course you wouldn't buy it. And you will want to trust this big company that they are taking good care. They have so much money. They are reassuring us with all this advertisement and marketing, but it really is not true. And I was too close to it, and I saw it, and it was the moment when I was like, okay, I have to leave my work. And I left my corporate career, and the moment I was like, okay, if you cannot work in it because it's too dirty, Camilla, you cannot shop, you cannot buy this anymore. It's total elitism, you know. It's like, okay, I don't want to, it's too dirty to work in, but I need a new pair of jeans. And I'm writing about it in my first autobiography. And at the moment, I was like, for maybe 2 weeks, I was wishing for gold jeans at H&M. And I was like, okay, I allow myself this last one. I don't want to see the chemicals and the price and where it's made. I didn't check any. I was like, okay, this is my last treat. And then I stopped shopping. And I left my corporate career, and it's still going on. And still better and better.
Fantastic. This is actually amazing what you're sharing with us, because you're absolutely right. When we go to the shops, everything is so glossified. Everything looks packaged so well, so attractive, so, you know, like glamorous, and you don't see the dirty scenes behind, right? They're well hidden. And even to trace them, like you said, when you're visiting the factories, the factory will be happy to sign any paper just to say, yes, we've got those conditions that you required, but actually obviously they don't have them in place, right? The working hours much, much longer, the working conditions for workers don't exist, breaks don't exist, and all that kind of stuff. And now...
And there's one more thing that is happening, and it's called subcontracting. You know, so the companies today, they publish the list of the factories they're working with. And the reality is that these factories really sign with them, okay, we're going to produce the clothes for you, but they don't have the capacity to do it often. Or, you know, like there's only few factories in the Far East that would apply to, like, comply to all these demands on the safety and not overtimes and stuff like this. And so they will take the order and give it to another factory. And this factory, nobody has ever visited it, you know. Nobody has ever seen it. There might be children. It's called sweatshop. Overtimes, people paid 60 euros a month, you know, which is below the poverty line. So if you, if somebody is working full time, getting this salary, it means they will never, they can never grow up economically. And this is the purpose of making clothes in Far East. It was the promise. We will give you work because you're much cheaper than we are, but we will help you to raise up. It's not really happening in the system, you know. So this is the other part of it, you know, that it, the companies, like the brands we are buying from, they would be like, but everything is fine, everything is safe. This company, like the supplier signed it, but it's not really what is happening there, you know.
The due diligence is not done fully. And then, you know, like you said, if they're outsourcing, you know, it like they can hide all this stuff, right? Even, yes. Even.
And it's illegal. You know, the subcontracting is illegal because the company said, we comply with your code of conduct. So we will make the order. And it's lying. And, you know, in my very short career, I got in touch with this. It's like, it's really happening. But even the people who work for those brands, and one more time, I was there as well. I was like, but what we are doing is fine. What we are doing is fine. But once you ask one question to the manager, you realize, oh, actually, it is not fine. You know, it's yeah, it's pretty crazy.
So lots of people in the industry may be even aware of what's happening, but, you know, kind of stick with it, right? They I think, like, just blinking, you know, that, like, it's not going to happen, nothing, there won't be any cause, right? There won't be any outcome as a result. We just carry on, and, you know, just take, and nothing will manifest itself in any other action. But, you know, you're absolutely right. I even noticed that food prices are going up, but clothes prices actually going down, and everything's so cheap. Yeah. And, you know, like, I can afford to buy disposable dress or jumper or skirt, you know, but it will be costing me less than, I don't know, you know, some expensive meal I will buy in the shops. And it's crazy, right? It's mad. It's really, really mad. And especially when, like, I'm originally from Belarus. When I go to Belarus, the clothes there are very expensive, you know, because there is no such a fast fashion production yet. And I don't shop clothes there anymore because I'm doing it here. It's much cheaper for me to buy in United Kingdom. And it's crazy. So, you know, like, your approach, it's slow fashion and, you know, kind of slow down, right? Tell me more about that. What do you mean by that? So how can someone go and shop with that in mind, right? You reveal us the truth, and it sounds really scary. And if we'll be more conscious of, you know, of that's happening, you know, then what can we do instead?
You know, and I think that this message that we've shared in the beginning, I think it's an important introduction, but it's not something that will make you stop shopping. It worked for me because I was, but I didn't stop shopping. I stopped working in it. And then I was like, it's too alibistic to continue shopping it, right? Because I was, as every chick out there, you know, I was going to the, and I'm from Czech Republic, post-communist country, girl from a poor family. So, like, to compensate this gap I had when I was a child, it's like new beautiful clothes, and I lived in Germany, and it was like I was hitting high street every week. And as you're saying, it's so affordable that you just keep shopping, and shopping is like little by little you are spending the cash. You don't even see it flying out. And then I came to UK and it was like much more crazy on the level, like living in London. And yeah, so I was like doing shopping all the time. And so for me, it worked this way. But what is important message for women who are the customers of the system, not working in it, is really like, check how much sense is in your shopping. How does it make you feel any good in the end? Because I think it's a lot about building this image, but we, like by building the image, we are just only focused on this surface. But what's going on inside? We are not, you know, like you put your attention on the surface, but your inner part needs the attention. And you are looking after the body, which is really, for me, is like one of the steps. Like you start, like, it's not you start somewhere, but you have to take it as a full package. You have the soul, you have your psychology, then you have the body, which means if you don't feel good in your body, no clothes will ever make you feel like a star. It's bullshit, excuse my French, but there is all the marketing is trying to make us believe that if you buy a new dress, you will be more beautiful. Darling, it ain't true. You know, like it will work for few minutes, if hours you're lucky on, but especially if it's like low quality, cheap, disposable, the fit will not be right. There will not be the time, the expertise, the love, the passion for the craft in this dress. Then it might change your vibe. Not if it's cheap, disposable, made in the conditions of modern slavery. How can this piece of material make you feel any better? And I will talk about this vibration, right? Like if you are rich, you don't have to dress in any way. And Parisian people, by the way, are amazing in this. Like the richest families in Paris, they would only dress up if they are meeting between themselves. But if they go shopping, if they go pick up kids at school, you're like, private school, seriously? You look like a homeless, you know, like you look like my grandfather. Like, what are you wearing? And they are really, really rich, but they don't need to show it. And I remember when I felt poor, because I've been there, you know, I felt like, and so you are like compensating the feeling of being poor by shopping, but it's not gonna take you where you want, right? Mm-hmm. So it's much wiser to take your resources from time, attention, energy, and money, and turn it in yourself, to yourself, like deeper than the clothes, because you have stuff to wear at home. This is the workshops I'm running now. It's like, I guarantee you will have something to wear every time if you just get rid of the clothes that have nothing to do in your closet. You need much less clothes. This is how it starts.
Actually, let's talk about that. And then having
like a clear vision.
Let's talk about that. So the topic of our today podcast was basically how to stop shopping, right? When you've got nothing to wear, yeah. Actually, you, like one of your favorites saying is, if you've got nothing to wear and you've got full closet, shopping is not the answer, right? So tell me more about that, because I think there are so many women out there who literally just got a full closet, bursting of clothes, but yet to struggle to look beautiful, to find something to wear, to dress in the morning and feel like absolutely gorgeous. And, you know, like sometimes when I open my wardrobe and I look through my items, I don't get inspired, you know, I'm just like, yeah, maybe, and then end up wearing the same stuff anyway. So what can we do?
You know, so first of all, is wear the same thing if this is the one that pleases you, but it's a good start, you know? Like what I'm saying is, if you have a full closet and you feel like you have nothing to wear, you need to unfuck it. It starts with that. Because, you know, the human brain has only limited capacity to take decisions. And there are studies, you know, if you have 12 marmalades to taste, people will buy much less than if you only have four, because the overwhelm of the choice gets you stuck. It will just, it will paralyze you because there's too much choice. And this is what we are doing to us by the fact that we are constantly shopping, right? So the more you shop, the more problems you are creating for yourself. Not to mention that you are spending money that you can use for better food, for example, or no financial stress, putting money aside for holidays, or I don't know, go support a charity. It's much more meaningful than creating this fashion system that's meaningless. So the first thing is that, like, if you want to always have something to wear, get rid of, I will be bold and say, get rid of 80% of your closet. You know, like I have clients who have like 600 references in their closet. You can never fucking wear it. Like the average would be something around 300. It would be like the average closet that I've met so far. So, you know, 300 references when there is proven evidence that you can, with 35 pieces, you can live at least a season, some women all year long. 35. Imagine, so you open the closet and you only have high quality pieces. This is what it starts with, because often you have clothes that are not worth of you. They're cheap. The material, like, you know, we are buying new clothes because we want to show that we value ourselves. You know, we want to show like, I'm rich, I've arrived, I have this new blouse, I need attention, I need somebody to tell me, oh, this is beautiful, right? I can tell you, I have such a closet that I'm getting, oh, you look beautiful all the time. But I'm all the time wearing the same thing because it's a high quality clothes, designer pieces, because I know that I can buy one thing and wear it for 5 years of shoes. I had a pair of shoes for 5-7 years easily. And so I know that if I buy with this mindset, it's not even a discipline. It comes so natural afterwards. I know that with this shopping habit, with this consumption habit, I can buy easily shoes for 350, 400 euros. And imagine what kind of quality it is for this price than if you buy something for 40 euros every year. You buy 40 euros every year. It's very, very different. So I have then the pieces that people go like, wow, I love your shoes. They remember me. My students remember me for what I was wearing because it's unique, high quality designer pieces. So if you want to dress up for your self-worth and valuing yourself, you need to consciously build a closet that will reflect your value and your confidence of who you are. But we are just drawn by the marketing and all this hypnosis of if you are a valuable person, if you are a rich person, you will just go shopping. But it is really not true. Like on the vibration level, this does not work. It will, these clothes are cheap. How do you want to feel rich in it? You know?
So where do you start? You know, like you said, you need to go and unpack for your closet, right? That's the term you use. So what do I do with that? Yes. So I open my wardrobe and I see so many different clothes there. I feel overwhelmed. And you said, get rid of 80% of it. So what do I do to start? You know,
okay. Julia, this is very radical. Of course, like it is super radical. This is what I would propose to my clients when we are doing the workshops, to like do this trial. But and this is a big step, like, excuse me, unfucking your closet. It's like defining who you are not and what you are not anymore. So I am teaching this as the unfuck your closet as the tool of personal transformation. It's always going to have an impact on your psychology, on your way of thinking, on your mindset. But but it would be my lifestyle hack we wanted to talk about. But the first thing you can start with is shopping detox. Like, give yourself your own period that you can go through. Like, maybe 2 weeks is too much for you. Maybe 2 weeks would be a real stretch. Not to go shopping, not online, not in the stores. 2 weeks, maybe this is something that would be like challenging for you. You can go 2 months as well. Like, it depends on your, you know, on your, because it's impulsive, right? It's impulsive. Like, it's such a part of your daily routine and going to this. So you define yourself some period and see, like, stop shopping and just observe that you always have something to wear, you know, or just start pulling out the pieces from the bottom of the piles. Like, I'm saying, I need something new. I just pull the one that is on the bottom of the pile because I have not seen it since a few months and it's new, you know. So these are maybe the first two strategies, like to slowly start, you know. Then during the workshops that I'm running, we really go much deeper in the mindset, because you can, and I'm sure this is what you understand very well, is the same with the body. The discipline is very limited. You have to incarnate it in who you are and find pride in I'm not shopping. And it is the total contrary of what this society is telling us. Everybody is telling you, be proud of you because you're shopping. Be proud of you because you are contributing to the economy. And the more you contribute, the prouder be of yourself. But it's not working for us. You know, we are still pulling the money out of our pockets to fund the dreams of somebody else. And finally, our pockets are empty. Our accounts are empty in the end of the month. Our dreams are still in a drawer. You know, we have not lived what we wanted. And we are just focusing all our resources, energy, attention, money, and time. It's out there in the shops. So this is the mindset shift. And then it's like defining what is really your style, who you are, and then keeping in your closet only the pieces that are in line with this vision. And this is what we do in the slow style workshops now.
Fantastic. So the challenge would be, and you know, I'll definitely encourage myself to do that next time when I go shopping and I've seen an item that I've got urge to buy, it's actually stop myself from buying it and just feel and think, why do I want to buy it? What's going on? Let's say if it's a pair of shoes, do I have a pair of shoes at home that I wear? You know, is it because like I don't have any shoes at all? You know, but like any woman got at least one pair of shoes guaranteed in her wardrobe. Totally. I love that.
And there is one more thing is often we are shopping what we already have at home. Mm-hmm. So if you have this, if you are really shopping trends, it means you have trends at home. And you have to like define your style to get step out of this. And I wanted to say something else. If you go to the shop and you see a pair of shoes that you like, I guarantee you don't need them. The like slow style, slow shopping. I don't call it shopping then. I call it investing in yourself. Because shopping is this impulsive, like you're going down the street, you see something in the window, you go and check it, oh, that is cute. You will explain to yourself in any way that you need it. Even if you don't need it, you need in your head now this process of like, oh, but I don't have any top to wear with these trousers, and you will just explain it to yourself. So this might not really work. The only thing that really works, like it's the shopping detox means also like window shopping detox and magazine detox, like stop absorbing this information. You really have to close your bubble and be sure that what you have is already good. And I guarantee you, it's just like we are trained to look at the stuff in our closet as like, oh, it's obsolete, it's too old, I need something new, but it's a hypnosis. It is not true, you know? This is not true. Like you just need to have a new set of eyes and much smarter mindset when you go and open your closet. And another part of this, you know, maybe Julia, so slow shopping means that you know you need trainers and then you are looking for them. Maybe for 2 years, you know, it can relate because you have trainers at home already. So now if you are going to invest in a new pair of trainers, you will want to buy the crème de la crème. You know, you will want to buy the best, the cherry on the cake, like the ones you will really love and be so happy and fulfilled and proud to wear them for a long time. And you cannot find them like this often, or you cannot even afford them like this. You know, sometimes these pieces are a little bit more expensive, or you would look for them. I'm buying basically only secondhand or designer pieces. So I am, you know, like either it's something that is out there and I can get it secondhand, or it's something so unique and I want to support local designers, creators, and economy. So this is how I shop or sustainable brands. And so I will take like really long time to find my pair of Jordans in my size in the good shape to buy on Vinted or, you know, on the online bazaar. So then like, don't go to shops, find something and try to stop yourself. It might really not be possible this mindset is so strong, you will be there and it will come with all the excuses why you need it. And I know this with, you know, it's this impulsive behavior that we are trying to overcome. It might be eating, it might be seeing the wrong guys, which is my case. Mm-hmm. You know, like, no, I know he's a jerk, but you know, I really this and that want to see him. You will not stop yourself. It's more like being very conscious and clear in your head about what item you need in your closet. Is this like conscious, intentional building of the wardrobe you need? And then take time to find the right piece. You know, there's no hurry. So this would be more the mindset of slow shopping. And if you are in this first stage, when you're still like, oh, let me go there. And then like, oh, okay, I left and I didn't buy it. The first thing you can try is that when you are standing there and this blouse is really beautiful, if it's possible, go home. And if you still think about it 1, 2, 3 days later, if you're like, yeah, but this was the one. I know this was the one. I know I fell in love with it because I'm still thinking about it. With all the distraction with the social media, my work, all the other windows, I still am thinking about this one particular blouse. Go back and buy it. Mm-hmm. You know, this might be the true love.
Oh, I love that. It's true match. And, you know, like also what I feel and I find, and I'm sure probably lots of women like finding the same, because the fashion is so fast. If you leave it for 3 days, A, you're not going to get your size. B, it's just gone and something new comes in. So you feel like if I've seen it, I have to buy it today and now, because tomorrow it's not going to be there and I've missed my chance and that's will be it. And it's like drama, right, in your head.
I know. And this is exactly how they want us to work. It's called marketing. It's intentional. This is exactly how it was designed for us to feel this like pressure to spend our money here and there in their store. So be smarter. You're stronger than them, right? Like don't, it's all this like psychology of shopping, which is also part of this like mindset program, like them, like uncovering, dismantling of this marketing strategies that exactly put you in this, like telling me this is totally normal. It's nobody's fault. It's a public hypnosis that's keeping us poor and ruining this planet. This is the result, you know, like we are all losers in this game because the air is just one air and the water is just one water and people, we are just one. And we are really like running against ourselves in the system. So, you know, when this happens, you didn't buy the blouse, you went home. 1 week later, I am still thinking about this blouse. I'm going back to buy it. If it's not there, you know, it was a sign of the universe that you don't need it. You know, like find the peace inside you. It's really about being so sure about who you are and your values that whatever happens, you're just peaceful. Peaceful with, okay, that was not supposed to happen. It was maybe not the right material for me. Like God saved me from spending my money on this one when actually I need new braces for my daughter. I don't know what it is, you know, it's just destiny then.
Oh, cool. I love that approach. I love that approach. So to remove that pressure and, you know, thinking that you're going to miss out on something, if it's happened, just accept it. And I guess be more than conscious if you really like that blouse, you know, like maybe specific style or color, then consciously go out there and, you know, seek it out in different ways.
Yeah. And, you know, like recently I met a woman in a metro in Paris and I'm all about fashion. So and she was wearing such a beautiful blouse. I was like, I would lick it on her. I was like, oh, it's beautiful. So I asked her because it's beautiful to speak. And people in Paris and metro don't talk to each other. I'm so weird here. And I would be like, oh, this is a beautiful blouse. Where did you get it? And she's telling me, is this in this brand? But you know what? It's so expensive. Go to Vinted. Put the name of the brand. And so, you know, if the blouse is out there, either you will find it in an online shop in your own size, you know, in the right size. And if not, you will find it in a secondhand in your size. Like it's possible. And if you cannot find it, if it's not there and you don't want to waste your time and money searching for it, then it is not the true love and it's just the destiny. You are not the right match.
I love that. I love that. And what's your take, you know, like on those new shops like Vinted, you know, on all the like charity shops, you know, all these all these kind of different ways now coming out, how we can exchange clothes, sell our old items. What, you know, what do you take on that one?
That's amazing. It's part of the circular economy, which means extending the life of the products we already have. And so, like, decreasing slowly the production of the new clothes. Just to tell you, fashion industry within 15 years doubled the amount of clothes we are producing. Between year 2000 and 2015, we have doubled the volume of clothes we are producing.
That's really
and
scary.
And still, vintage is already here. So imagine with all these clothes, we are also like producing double the amount of textile waste. And a lot of this is never even solved. You know, like this system is broken. If you want to do something to protect this planet for our kids, protect your own cash, protect only your like mental sanity, you know, it's really time to step out of it and be find the security and find the confidence in yourself that you're already fine, darling. You got everything you need in your closet. I'll show you. But Vinted is great, and all these scenarios are great. And one more time, the first step is to use this as a way to protect our planet and, you know, decrease the consumption extend the life of the product. And at the same time, it's also still very important to get this new mindset of like, I already have everything. I'm only shopping. I'm only investing. I'm not shopping. I'm only buying things very slow. I'm only investing in the pieces I really need and I really want. So, you know, it can be Vinted where the things are pretty cheap or you can find it's like desired pieces. Or it can be even the fact that somebody gives you clothes and you just, it's for free. So you just take it all and then you flood one more time. You flood your closet and you create this paralysis of I have nothing to wear because it's so packed that I don't see the trees for the forest, right? You need to keep your space very like clean space, clean ideas, you know, like it has so much impact on how we feel and how much clarity we have in our life. If we have the clarity in the closet, we have the clarity in our mind. It's like a reflection of our inner state. So if you unfuck your closet and only keep what really is resonating with you, then you will have a much clearer idea about where you want to go with your life or how do you want people to treat you. Like it has a humongous impact on our lives.
Absolutely. I can really relate to having that, you know, really clean wardrobe. Like I've done, because obviously with my journey with my health and my weight, I've lost lots of weight. Therefore, lots of clothes don't fit me anymore. And I've ended up with a wardrobe that I used to wear maybe 15 years ago, which now I realize I'm not that girl anymore 15 years ago. And so I can't really wear many items. So I've got basically nothing to wear. So it took me like a couple of goes at my wardrobe to decide what I keep, what I'm letting go off, and also admit to myself that big size, I don't need anymore. You know, I'm saying goodbye to that big size. And my sister, funny enough, when I went to see her, my sister lives in Paris. So when I went to see her, she gave me some of her pieces because she, you know, she put weight on, you know, she is having second baby and she said it's going to probably take me ages to come back to my figure. So, but she has those, you know, really, really nice pieces. So she gave me some and I've, you know, picked and I was really happy. But actually realizing, like you said, they actually started to fill my wardrobe and it was her story, not mine. And I'm thinking there are a few items that, you know, I like and I want to wear, but actually most of them, it's like I didn't choose them. I didn't buy them. I was given, you know, it was given to me and it's not my story. It's not my joy and pride wearing them, even though there is nothing wrong with them. They're absolutely gorgeous and beautiful, but I didn't resonate it with me. So I'm kind of packing them away from my wardrobe because they were taking space again. I'm like opening up thinking I've got this lots of gorgeous like items to wear, but actually I don't feel like I want to wear them, you know, anymore.
Yeah, it's not you.
So I absolutely can resonate with that. And you know, one thing I've noticed since I've cleaned my wardrobe in that way, It's so much quicker to dress up in the mornings. Yes. Your decisions are really quick.
Yeah.
You don't have to spend ages to decide what to wear. Would I look, you know, all that self-dialogue that you're having first thing in the morning. It's just so, so simple, so quick. And like you said, you know, wearing the same clothes day in, day out, like I'm finding there is nothing wrong with that. You know, if it looks good on you and it makes you feel good, why not? You know, who wrote that rule, right? That you have to wear like different clothes every single day, and change them or whatever. And I think I can absolutely relate to this simple, clean wardrobe. It's the benefit of it, you know, like for me personally, was massive, you know, like I didn't realize that because I always was shopping girl, always thought I need to have lots of items to wear, like need to have big wardrobe, big choice, like different colors, like just the same item in different colors, what in case. Yeah, so it's and my next actually challenge is I'm going to go, and I haven't done it, and I didn't even think about this before, actually. I'm going to go through my shoes collection and have clearance there because I've recently realized my shoes are everywhere, in every single wardrobe, every single under bed or somewhere, and I haven't actually worn them, like, for a very long time, and I've picked up one pair, and I'm thinking, I don't think I actually want to wear this anymore, you know? Like, it's not me, and I'm became mom, so wearing heels is not part of my every single day activities. So I only keep comfortable heels and those that, you know, I can wear for specific occasions, but all other ones is not me anymore. And I might as well just clear that space and, you know, like clear that space in my brain as well and kind of say goodbye to those items.
And I think that this is exactly the moment where vintage is so important. First, like when you are getting rid of the pieces, really put them out there. Like I know it's taking time in the pictures. It's the application now. So I think it might be pretty easy. You are in UK charity shops. This is amazing. We don't really have this here. But at the same time, like try to keep it as local as possible. And at the same time, like you will see so many of these pieces are just unsellable, unwearable, undesirable. Like it doesn't work. It's one part. And the other part is, please go shopping there. And I know it's taking more time, but I think like the charity shops, it's questionable. Like, you know, it's the quality of the things today. It's all that. But if you are looking for something specific, please first check on Vinted if it's not there today, but it's still like the joy of shopping. So you wouldn't mind doing the same thing in 1 week and check again. Like I'm still looking for my watch that I lost when I was pregnant and I don't want any other. I still don't have any watch and this is the only one I want. So like from time to time, I open Vinted and I just check if I find it there. And just recently, you know, I found my pair of trainers, Jordans, by the way. I've always dreamed about, not always, since 4 years, I met a guy in the metro 4 years ago and he was wearing these amazing shoes. And I was like, what's the brand? And he's like, it's Jordans. And I didn't even know it, you know, like on Czech market, they don't exist, I guess. I've never heard about this brand before. But from that day, I was totally obsessed by the design. And I'm very visual. I'm designer by origin. So I'm like, oh, I need those shoes. Maybe 2 years later, I'm walking down the path. I went for a jog and I found a plastic bag next to a trash bin full of shoes of my size.
Wow.
So I took 7 pairs of them, by the way, unworn, a part of these, and they were the Jordans, right? They were Jordans in my size, a little bit used, but anyway, so you spray them to like make sure they are safe, right? And I have like 7 pairs of shoes at home, and Jordans were one of them. And for 2 years, I was really wearing them like a lot. And now like, it was the end of their life for me. Like I can wear them to the fields, but not even to have a lunch, you know? And so I go to this like online, I didn't buy it at Vinted, but I go check on Vinted and one more other website. And I put like Nike, Jordans, women 40, which is my size in European measurements. And there's exactly the pair that this guy was wearing in the metro 4 years ago. I'm not kidding, exactly this model. In my size, hardly worn, €60. The new ones are like 200. Wow. And you know, and I don't even buy them for I don't buy them for the status. I'm just so passionate about this design. I don't care who made them at that stage because I'm like, I love this design. Otherwise, usually I'm really going for local small brands. Like I would never go and buy new shoes from Nike. I don't think I have this values anymore. But you know, like it took me 4 years, but this is the slow shopping. This is the real investing and it will come the right moment, what you're looking for. It will come. And a big part of this like slow shopping is this vision of it's like you have the mood board and you're looking at it and you are shaping your wardrobe and you are taking decisions when you are in the store and you see it's like, oh, beautiful, it's red. But in my mood board, I have nothing red at home. Basically, red is not, it's not my color. For example, if I wear red, it's reflecting in my face and I look red in my face and it's not nice. It's like I look drunk all the time with red on me, you know. So I was observing what colors, and I do the same work with my clients. I'm not even coming there and telling them, oh, your skin is this color, so this is your colors, like based on some rules. You don't need to go anywhere and study. You only need to observe, like close your bubble, don't let any information that would be distracting you, all these marketing messages and all these values of the society of endless shopping and you cannot wear the same cocktail dress twice. Delete this. Stay in your bubble. Ask yourself, what works for me, my finances, my sanity, my body? Because like all these new clothes are full of chemicals. You really don't want to put this on your body, actually. You know, there's this other aspect of it that wearing still the same and wearing secondhand, it's much safer in terms of health, you know, and having this confidence, it's more, it's really work on your fitness with Julia to feel great in whatever you have at home. Really, like if you feel like your body is toned and strong and you know, like you change maybe even your posture, you start wearing your chin up, whatever you wear, and you're like this. Whatever you wear, you look like the poor little girl and nobody respects you. Whatever you wear, and you are like, you know, your back is straight. You have this glow of the confidence and joy of life. I call it the well-fucked energy. You know, when you are in this, you are like, you will look beautiful in anything. So work on what is under the clothes. Don't like invest yourself there. And just for now, wear whatever you have at home. You might think it's not okay, but nobody else thinks that, really. It's just in our heads, like we are thinking, ah, this is not good enough and this is not modern enough. No one cares. Like it's just in our own head, this hypnosis of I have to keep shopping to feel good. No, you have to put your resources in yourself to feel good.
I love that. And you know, like for example, I love what you mentioned about the bubble, right? Kind of like protect yourself from outside influences and, yeah, you know, tune into yourself. But let's say if someone is struggling to like put those pieces together, know the colors and, you know, how to put the items together, would you suggest to go to stylists, for example, and get some professional advice? And there are so many, you know, social media posts are there. There are different stylists putting things together, you know, kind of in magazines, you know, you will see. Would you suggest to do that?
I would tell you, go try if it works for you, but keep your eyes open if it doesn't. You know, like really question everything you hear. Be very, very alert about, does this message resonate with me? Is this actually serving me? And I know we were talking about this together, that often the stylist would come and exactly come with the rules. And even I'm stylist of any kind, you know, it comes with. One will tell you, you need a capsule wardrobe. You only need this and this many pieces and more is wrong. I would not even say that, you know. I'm just saying, have a clarity. Because maybe you are a Carrie Bradshaw type of person and you need a lot of clothes for different occasions and the dresses. It's your personality. Don't deprive yourself of that. But just make sure that there is clarity in it. There is space. The energy can flow. That it's joy when you open it and you know. Like you will really realize the moment when you wake up every morning, you open the closet and there's always something to wear. You have arrived. Okay. This is the,
I think that's hallelujah moment, right? You open your wardrobe. It's like, oh, It's singing to you.
And you know, it's like for me, it got into such an, I would call it extreme, that I opened my closet and I was like, oh, I can wear this dress. I really feel like this dress. And it's like, oh, basically I can also take, I have like 3 outfits in the morning, and I knew like whatever I take, I will feel like a goddess in it. Imagine that. Not only I feel like I always have something to wear, but I can almost like choose out of 3 outfits that really make me feel the power and the confidence, and I know who I am. But it's really coming from this confidence of I don't need to shop to prove anything to anybody, right?
So your wardrobe, you know, your holy grail wardrobe should consist only of pieces that make you feel like that, right? Make you feel amazing, make you feel like when you open it, when you look at them, like you're so inspired, you feel so high, you feel so like, you know, you're going to look your best and your top, not those type of items that you're like, that's will do for today. Yeah. You know, tomorrow I might be, I'll have more time to think what I'm going to wear, right?
You are wasting the potential of your closet to improve the quality of your life and the way you feel. And I believe life is just about it. Life is just the feeling, you know. And we all heard these stories like, how much money you have does not matter. In the end, like, yeah, health is important, but you can be sick and feel amazing still, like, be so grateful. So invest into this, cultivate this, instead of just like being drawn by the trends and social media of like, you need this and you need that. This is not making you happy. And I will just go back to the stylist part where, so like my clients who worked with other stylists before, they would tell me like, yeah, like this woman, like she helped me with this and that. So I would believe that if you are seeking advice, first you will anyway check who is that person. If you resonate with that person, hire that person, follow her, follow the message, you know, like, so you will find some tricks of what to apply in your wardrobe from her work. So this is, I think it's totally legitimate, but maybe, and I myself really struggle with finding somebody who I will really resonate with, because I have this value of protecting the nature and being allocentric, which is the opposite of egocentric. I'm not dressing just to prove that I have arrived. I'm not dressing for this at all. I'm dressing up for expressing my emotions and who I am. My mood, let's say, and then I'm dressing up to show that I care. You know, I'm taking all my choices in terms of my closet and what I'm wearing, and it goes down to my work, my life mission, the way I educate my daughter. I'm doing everything with love and respect for life, and life, it means this planet and everything that is on it, that it was created here as the environment that is feeding us and nurturing us and healing us. Like, this is like, it's omnipresent in my life. So I'm sure there are other stylists who have this approach, right? But if you have those values, like, try to find somebody who really reflects them, who can even, like, you know, take you further into this respectful way of living and dressing up.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Camila, for that. You know, I'm really picked up so many ideas and so many reflections for myself, and I'm sure the audience have as well. Just, you know, to name a few, next time you're out there shopping, you know, you've got the urge to buy that item, stop yourself from doing that. Get home, think about it, allow yourself 2-3 days, see how you feel. And if you come back and that item has gone, not a big deal. It can manifest itself in other ways, like Vinted, eBay, charity shop. Maybe your friend will give it to you, or ask that person, like you said, in the metro, right, where they got it from. So those kind of items out there, and try to create a holy wardrobe, right? Which when you open, it sings to you, right? And you will make you feel beautiful. It will make you on the top of your game, rather than make you feel overwhelmed and kind of box you down and you feel like you've got nothing to wear. And 80% of your wardrobe maybe should be gone, you know, to create that, right? So this is only a few tips I'm picking up from you. I would love chatting to you more. You know, you're such an inspirational woman. And thank you so much for sharing your insight on fashion industry that's truly, truly eye-opener. And as you know, all of my guests, always at the end, I do ask them a question. If there was one lifestyle hack, you know, things that they can use today to improve their life and implement today, what that will be, what would you share with them?
Yeah, as I said, I revealed it already when we were chatting. Like, I would really invite you to do the shopping detox, because it's the way for your mind, you know, it's the way to train your mind that I stopped shopping, I still have stuff to wear. And this is what you need to get in your mind. Like, I don't need to go shopping to dress up. You don't need to go shopping for any reason. You just start investing in yourself then, like when you work deeper on your mindset. So I would really invite you to put yourself a period of time that is feasible for you. Maybe put on your fridge the number of the dates and cross the day every day. Like, okay, I can handle it. Like 2 weeks without shopping. You can handle 2 weeks without shopping. Maybe if you have some plans for the Black Friday, and I would even invite you to do it now. Skip the Black Friday if you are watching it anytime soon. So, you know, like go cross out the dates and go without the shopping and you will see how it feels. Maybe you are saving a lot of time. You are saving a lot of money. Write down every item you have resisted to, you know, and see how much money it is in a month. Like, these are just the first exercises to get conscious and get more confidence in, I have it all already. Because we won't all just have it all, but secret to having it all is knowing you already do. And this is how you will train your mind to believe that you got it all, baby. You got it all.
Fantastic. So the kind of slow challenge, right? Set yourself a slow challenge for whatever that might be. 2 weeks, 2 months, you know, depends how fast you shop, right?
Right.
Fantastic. Well, and if any of the listeners want to find out more about you and, you know, all the kind of things that you shared with us today or get in touch, what will be the best way to find Camila?
You can put the links below the video if we will put it up there. It's Kamilabudova, Kamilabudova.com. So these are my websites where you will find more resources and online programs. If you are in Paris, I'll be happy to come to your place and unfuck your closet with you and help you to switch your mindset. And I've seen amazing results with my clients who really are calling me the best fashion coach ever. And like, their style has changed, their vibe has changed, their light has changed. Really, like, the women, they found through this process so much more confidence and femininity and, you know, like power to go out there and just be beautiful even, you know, because we have so many limiting beliefs around this, you know. So it's really like a truly deep work to unfuck your closet if you have this intention to do it and use it as a tool of your personal transformation. It has really this power to change you.
Fantastic. Brilliant. So your website, you also wrote 3 books, right?
Yeah.
And where?
All in Czech now, but there might be coming soon in English or French. But yeah, it will be all on my website if it's ever out in any other language than Czech.
Fantastic. And then you do consultation, right? And you can do online consultations.
Yes.
If anyone is interested to unpack their closets and get into that holy grail of their closets. Brilliant. Well, thank you so much, Camila. And I really want to thank all the listeners that stay with us until the end. And as my business, Julia Fitness Coaching, I'm always here to support and help you to get to your dreams and make your life much better in any way. So all my guests that coming on the show always try to share their best and their brilliance with you so you can benefit from it. From it straight away, whether it's a mindset, whether it's your body, health, or anything to do around your life. Thank you so much, and we'll speak to you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.